We're going to do the whole book of Jude tonight. In its entirety. So get ready. You know, this morning we ministered on 2 Peter chapter 3. If you were not in the meeting, you need to listen to the YouTube. You need to grab a hold of the tape. I want you to turn that bigger fan off. Is it needed? Hallelujah. It's kind of difficult to get a recording that can bless a lot of people when there's a jet aircraft taking off just outside the door. You know what I'm saying? It's, of course, quite a bit of an exaggeration, but it can almost sound like that sometimes on a recording. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just hope tonight that you just come to understand that it's not hard to follow the Holy Ghost when you are willing to just simply be submitted and yielded to Him, when you're willing, when you're just desperate for the abundant life instead of the abandoned life. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't have an abandoned life when you can have an abundant life. It's not that difficult, people, to get happy when you're sad, huh? To be agreeable when you feel a little bit ornery and cantankerous, huh? Are you listening to me? And if you don't think that you're going to have these kinds of issues, I'm just bringing you into the light right now. You know, we've been ministering to you over the past couple of days on being fit and equipped to deal with temptation. Being fit and equipped to be able to stand in the day of evaluation and to be found in Him. Hallelujah. And you're just going to have to get with God's program instead of your program. So, I mean, people want sympathy and empathy. They want everybody to just sympathize with them. And there's nothing going to go. That's not anything that has nothing to do with faith. It has nothing to do with faith, and you ain't going to get anywhere. And if anybody tolerates that in your life, shame on them, starting with you. You know what I'm saying? If you're going to tolerate in your life, I certainly am not going to. And that day right now, you won't tolerate it. You wouldn't tolerate it in your children's life when they were small. You wouldn't. I can tell you, give you a lot of examples where you wouldn't tolerate that kind of stuff, that moping about kind of stuff, you know. And that behavior that just was, you know, it wrecks everything. We just want you to come just to understand what it means to be obedient children. And so I want you to get ready tonight, and because I'm going to hit you with some pretty intense stuff. I'm going to hit you with things that could easily be potential things that are trying to influence you. They're trying to persuade you. They're the impacts of the prince and the power of the air, the spirit of the atmosphere, if you would, have only one place that they cannot operate and influence. And that is the place where someone is immersed down into, baptized in the Holy of Holies, baptized in the Holy Ghost, baptized in the person and presence of the living God. Otherwise, to some degree or other, you are being influenced by the spirit of this world, which really is the design behind all the social structure of men, all the sociology of men, and really, by and large, all the way that government functions within the realms of humanity. Now, you want to be free from that influence? You want to be able to walk where you're not under the load of that thing? Where you're not constantly in heaviness? If need be, praise God for heaviness if it's needed. So long as it's going to work the peaceable fruits of righteousness, so long as it's going to, out of that tribulation, worked in your life a response of obedience to God after so long a time. Because I'm telling you right now, the same sun that makes the wax melt makes the clay hard. And people want to talk about it concerning Pharaoh's heart, but I want to talk about it concerning God's people's hearts. Because God's people are going to have to learn how to take hold of themselves. God's people are going to have to begin to deal with the influences of the atmosphere, recognize them for what they are, and shut them down. Because it's not going to get shut down just by a passive response, just saying, well, we're all having to deal with this, and then worse than that, inviting those things in your home, people. Listen, I'm telling you, folks turn on the television and they invite all kinds of things into their lives and into their homes. They turn on the radio, invite all kinds of things into their homes and into their lives. And there is another television and there is another radio that's being broadcasted. And it's right being broadcasted directly to your mind. And in fact, that is even a worse programming. That's worse than HBO, Sin to the Max, and all the rest of them. It's really being direct. I praise that you get this. I want everybody to get this. HBO stands for Hell's Box Office. I want you to understand that. Cinemax is literally pronounced Sin to the Max. I want you to get that, okay? That way, if you're tempted to deal with it, you know exactly where you're going with this thing, okay? Hallelujah. It's getting worse every day. But I want you to understand that there's the same kind of broadcasting going on. In, as it were, an unseen agency. And it's going right into the mind. And you better understand how to rise up with the Word of God and the Spirit of God and cast that nonsense down. You know, I try to help people understand a real simple principle. Discouragement comes from hell or beneath. Encouragement comes from heaven or above. I mean, it's just simple. If you can get that, man, you're already well on your way to moving in the discerning of spirits. Amen. You're well underway now dealing with the battle that rages against you and having an insight to know what you should yield to. Somebody said, I'm just under discouragement. Well, just start being encouraged. Well, I just don't know how to. This discouragement's hit me right, left, and center. Well, you know what? I'm going to tell you right now, you've got various different priorities. Maybe priority number 13 and 14 didn't work out and you focused on them so you discouraged. So why don't you jump back up to number one and just basically that you've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb and your name's written in the Lamb Book of Life and get focused back on that. You know what I'm saying? Don't stay on 17 and 18. Or who knows, 103 and 104 down the list. 103 and 104 is not working out, so I'm so discouraged. Why don't you jump back up to one? Amen. Hallelujah. Father, sorting things out in people's lives all the time because they've got wrong, they've got inappropriate affections. They've got their trust in the wrong place. They're looking for love in all the wrong places. They're trying to get fulfilled in all the wrong places. That was a good song. Somebody got inspired. Amen. You know what I'm saying? And that is true. It's really, really true. And so that's why a lot of trial, a lot of tribulation goes on in people's lives because they've got to recognize, man, your heart's not right. You're trying to get something from somebody else that only God can give you. You're going to have to get a relationship with the Lord and stop trying to get it from me. Hallelujah. Ramon, you try to get something from me that only God can give you. I appreciate you thinking so highly of me and everything. But you need to get your attention directed in the right place. Hallelujah. Purosateya. Konamanjaya. And the beautiful thing of it is that the Holy Ghost is here to empower us and strengthen us to give us the ability to do these things. God has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Woo! What a life. You talk about the high life. Ha ha! There's no higher life than the heavenly life. Woohoo! The abundant life is everything that pertains to life and godliness. My goodness gracious, this is the most exciting, thrilling thing. In his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand, pleasures forevermore, taking care of us, going before us, surrounding us, filling us, protecting us, blessing us, keeping us so that we suffer no lack, no want. God's people are not to know any kind of poverty. That's what God says. Those who fear the Lord shall not have any lack. God's people didn't know no poverty, no lack. Has nothing to do with giving in the offering either. How you like that? How you like that? I'm raining on your parade. Has to do with the way you fear the Lord. It's how the way how you depart from evil. That's where God describes his blessings. How you walk in obedience. How you walk in faithfulness to God. Hallelujah. You know, does giving and sowing and blessing the ministry and taking care of orphans and widows and taking care of traveling ministries in the local house, does that have an important role to play? Absolutely. But I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, it's just one in the number among many. It ain't singularly it as many people want to try to portray it to be. It's nonsense. Because I can stack up the verses of Scripture on God's blessing and provision concerning fear of the Lord, departing from evil, obeying God, walking in obedience and being in faithfulness, and then describe that to somewhere where people want to monetize it in an offering. My goodness gracious, don't even compare. A couple of verses of Scripture versus hundreds. Don't even compare. Why is the emphasis placed in the wrong place? Well, I'm going to talk about that. I talked about it this morning. Once again, if you did not listen, if you were not here, rather, if you didn't listen, that's two, true two. If you were here, but you did not listen, or if you were not here at all, listen to this morning's YouTube. Praise God for those who, you know, Elizabeth and Kate and the team, and I know that they can utilize help in that area as well. If you want to be a part, there's no more effective media than the media of being able to get a YouTube out there to do film and that kind of presentation of the gospel. And, I mean, there's so many ideas. Dr. Stu is sharing with some things that he had, you know, where it's just like times, they're just these powerful 5-minute things that go forth or 30-second or 2-minute things that go forth in the meeting where people may not want to be able or may not have the time or just don't have the interest or understanding to sit there and listen to the whole hour and a half, or in many cases, I preach 4 hours, but you know. But at any rate, but if we have more people who understood how to be a part of that, who knew how, when we were actually ministering, just to jot down, you know, it's about 8 o'clock right now, and something as powerful was there, and we need to hand that off to the folks who are involved in media, and I think Jeremy's also involved in it. If you want to be involved in media, I really want to see people raised up in every level to bless the ministry. In every level, hallelujah. First thing you got to do is master your spirit. That's what we're working with Naomi on here, okay? Because these other interests begin to overwhelm her, and she acts almost possessed with that other interest at the expense of not even being able to hear anything else. But that doesn't just happen with little ones. It happens with big ones, too. But, you know, we want to raise people up. We want to see people become effective in the ministry, to be able to help in sound, to be able to minister and help in music, to be able to minister and help in all the various different media, especially film media. And then that way, it doesn't matter where God sends you, you are equipped. You have ability, and maybe I pray God would send you in some place, a Holy Ghost church someplace, sometime in your life. They don't have any of these things, and if they had them, I mean, it would just, they'd become so much more effective and reach thousands of more people. I mean, it was told me over and again how many different nations tune in to the YouTube channels and to the FM channels, and it's just, it is just wild to think of. It's so many. I read about it and look at the statistics, and I'm just so bewildered by it. I'm like, wow, this is amazing to be able to touch that many people's lives. And, you know, there's enough people around here that have training that if you truly give it over to God within the framework of computer training or other type of technology training, you really give it over to God, what you could be a part of in terms of advancing the gospel would blow your mind. Satan always tries to make everything about our lives and all that we're doing and all that we are so insignificant. He tries to marginalize everything that we become so discouraged we don't do anything. And you're just going to have to learn how to rise up against that stuff and kick it in the head. I got special boots. I'm selling them tonight for free. All you got to do is be willing to take hold of it. I'm telling you right now, you'll get to a place that God, it won't matter what's coming out against you. Nothing can stop you. There are times where we're working so hard. We've been working so hard 12 hours a day, sometimes even more, and we just dragging. But I'm telling you right now, we're still moving. We're still moving. We might be moving somewhat slow after having done it for about 14 days. You don't need to get a little bit of a rest, but we ain't nothing going to stop us. We're still moving. It might even be after dark, but we're still moving. As long as you're still moving in the direction of getting something done, people, come on. Now you're finding yourself being equipped. You're finding yourself being empowered because Father doesn't look at anybody doing that and just basically pass them on by. He responds with all heaven to fill us up to make sure that everything that we've set our hearts to do in Him will be successful. You just do not stop. You just do not give up. You just stay at it. You will succeed. That's God's promise. Do not weary in well-doing because you faint not. You shall reap. Hallelujah. Those who sow to the Spirit are going to reap the products of everlasting life. Just don't stop. You know, you just come to a place where you just don't respond to discouragement. You just don't respond to the atmosphere. You don't respond to that channel. If people talk about television all the time, they should. They talk about movies, wrong, unholy, lascivious movies, and they should. Wrong, unholy, lascivious music, and they should. And other kinds of programming. Wrong and unholy CNN broadcasting and Fox News Network and others, and they should. Because that stuff is just about as wild and just about as crazy and planting just about as much of deceptive seed as anything else. You listening to me? You'd know more shutting in with God than any news commentator ever gave you. God, the Holy Ghost has come to show us what truth is and tell us what's really going on. Amen. Hallelujah. I know it's good to check in with the weather, but you know what? They don't even get it right there either. Hallelujah. Man, Jeremiah. And if you didn't get so bogged down with what they were saying about the weather, you might have more effect on it yourself. Seeing as the fervent prayers of a righteous man avails much. Amen. Hallelujah. How? Bogarena Manjajaya. God wants to build you up. God wants to build you up so you can step into your inheritance. Hallelujah. That's what Paul said. I said, I commend you to the word. Amen. And to the spirit. Woo! Which are able to build you up. Hallelujah. And give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. We want you to begin to move effectively in the things that God has given you, but you're going to have to understand how to be fit and how to be equipped. And there's no way that I can review all of those messages that we've given over the past few meetings tonight. Praise God, we have them on YouTube. And those of you get locked down in that, and as you're doing that, and you're just, you know, listening, and something stands out to you, and you say, my, I believe this could be so effective, then you can begin to help take that word to a lost and dying church and a lost and dying world. Amen. And the more you labor doing that things, those kinds of things, the more you're earnest about people hearing the word of God, the more you're interested in seeing the anointing go forth by the Spirit of the Lord to break off the yokes, the more you're going to inherit in God. If you just basically can take it or leave it and you're just waiting for something else to happen, you know what? There's not enough hunger and thirst going on there for you to receive what God Father really has for you and wants for you. Hallelujah. Se kere mande, li palasate. I'm believing God for miracles tonight. I'm believing God for creative miracles tonight. You know something? There is a stirring that goes on. There's a stirring that goes on by the Holy Ghost. There is a building up that takes place by the word of God. That if we will respond to what God is doing, the atmosphere will be charged with faith instead of doubt and unbelief. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me? You know why? I don't know why it is, but I just get this sense and this feeling that somebody, the people, there's somebody in here, you're reading other books right now. You're looking at other things. I can't imagine that that's true, but I keep seeing this picture. And sometimes, you know, I'm not right 100% of the time. But sometimes, you know, but sometimes when these things coming back at me, hit me, I'm usually right. Don't do that. If that's going on somewhere in here, don't do that. Just stay right here with me. Just stay right over here with me, because you don't want to be irreverent to the things of God. If you were forced to come here tonight, you should tell whoever forced you that that doesn't go on in the kingdom of God. You know, no one should be forcing anyone to come here. This is not a required class. Are you with me? This is for the hungry and the thirsty. You know, if I'm dealing with the little kids right now, parents, you just need to get control of your children. You know, you need to command your house. I really believe in this. I've commanded my house. I've taught my sons that, listen, if you do not command your house, I mean, I'm impatient and I'm long-suffering. I try to work with something, but if it gets to a place where, hey, wait a minute, this is just getting carried away, I'm going to get down. I'm going to come down on it and say, stop it now. And I've taught my sons, command your house, because if you don't command your house, there's nothing going to, it's not going to work out. If you just try to soft pedal it and do it based upon the human mind and human understanding, it's not going to work out. Hallelujah. But you do it the way God says to do it, it's going to work out. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Is that what's going on? You feel the same way? You're just not getting your way tonight. Huh? It's just not going your way. But yet, if we really were asked to interview you exactly what you want, you would not be able to tell us. Other than you want to meander about and just do whatever it is you want to do. Yeah, exactly. Hallelujah. Just pay a little attention to me and I'll get happy. Praise God. Amen. Well, you know, there's place and time for that. Everybody needs that. You know, but the Lord wants to really pay some attention to you. On Wednesday night, I was just so struck by the prophecy that came forth out of Ruth Anna, where the Lord just began to plead and cry in such an intense way. I just want to bless you. I just desire to bless you. I'm pleading with you that I might bless you. And it's like, you know, I can see the dynamics there, because as having pastored for so many years now, almost around about 34 years pastoring, I can see how many people become distraught when we plead with them, because they can't see the provision and the answer. They just see rather the place and position that they're in. They are overwhelmed with discouragement because of their failure, because of the way things have been going on in their life. And they don't see that Father's standing there with all the provision and all the strength and all the ability. All they've got to do is repent. All they got to do is say, Father, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I don't want to live this way anymore. I want what you have for me. And then immediately a miracle takes place and change comes. There are a lot of things that are going to put pressure on you to go back, to do it the same way you've been doing it, to believe it and respond to it, things the same way you've been believing and responding. But if you just get into that place of that altar call mentality, that moment of consecration to the Lord, that moment of having heard the word of God. People, if you don't hear right, there's some kind of demonic interference. It's out of order. When people are not responding to God's word and his correction in the right way, there's something seriously out of order in their spirit and in their lives. And it usually has a reflection in their family, in their house, in their business, in their finances, in their relationships as well. Is that said to shame anyone? No, it's said to deliver everyone. And people got to hear right that God's bringing forth his word to heal us. God didn't send forth his word to make us worse. Praise God. He sent forth his word to heal us, but his word can't heal us unless you wait for a healing. Unless you desperate for a healing. Amen. So let the Spirit of the Lord have more influence on you than what Satan is broadcasting from the atmosphere. He's got satellites flowing up. He's got satellites spinning all around your head. You know what I'm saying? He's broadcasting all kinds of nonsense. It cannot penetrate when you have the Word of God for a shield. Hallelujah. When you've got the faith for a shield. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When his word is a buckler and a shield unto you. Hallelujah. Praise God. When faith is a shield unto you, praise the name of the living God. When you're overwhelmed by the Spirit of the Lord, I'll just tell you right now, you're dealing with some kind of a problem, a situation, harassing thoughts. Most people's stuff is just nothing but imaginary. It's not even real. It's imaginary. The first reaction is, you know, not something that is, you know, good and it's going to work out and everything's fine. It's a disaster, you know. Baby falls. The baby's immediately broke its neck. It didn't have done, nothing happened. It just barely didn't even get bruised. You know, everything's just so negative and it's so imaginary. But when there are things in Christ that begin to hit your life, whether they're real or imaginary, just begin to praise God. Begin to worship him. Begin to give thanks to the one who's faithful, who's protecting you, keeping you. Hallelujah. And nothing can discourage you if you don't walk in self-interest. People walk in competition and comparison, you're going to be taken out inside of a couple of months. You may want to walk with God, but you are not going to be able to so long as you walk under that rule. You don't have to get out of your self-interest thing. Huh? You got to have somebody pat you on the back every other day and say you're still doing good and can tell you, yeah, we still love you and like you and we care for you and want you here. You ain't going to make it. And that don't sound nothing like a cross, huh? The Lord called you, come take up your cross. Hallelujah. That means you're going to have to lay down your life. That means nobody likes you. They all saying crucify him. Away with him. Amen. You need to get comfortable with that. Amen. And so as I was saying this morning, in ministering of the last days, the perilous times that we're living in, this morning we were highlighting many of the things, the spiritual things that go on within the framework of the church. It has an outworking light right now in these last days of apostasy and an outworking in the church. And also then has an outworking, as it were, as things that are going to attack your mind. And so we're going to also then take this up again here in Jude chapter, in the whole book of Jude, forgive me, the whole book of Jude. And we're going to begin, hallelujah, in Jude chapter 1, verse 1. Praise the name of the Lord. Everybody just take a drink. Amen. Take a drink of the water which Father is supplying. Hallelujah. Just go ahead and take a drink. Take a drink of that water from on high. Hallelujah. See, if my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock. And what am I going to do when I get to the rock? I'm going to drink. I'm going to say to the rock, I need some water. And then the Lord says, you drink of this water, rivers will begin to flow out of you. Simply just say, I want you to make a commitment, get consecrated tonight to never being discouraged again. Say, I'm done with it. If you like discouragement, could you raise your hand? Then why have what you don't like? Why have what you don't want? Huh? I don't understand that. When God has given you the power and the ability to run it off. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, God's so good to us. He protects us. He's watching over us. He's going with, you know, one day, Ruth Anna was out in front of me on her little bicycle, and I was behind her, and she's riding up the dirt road on her ranch, and two very large coyotes come right out after her. I never told her about it, but what happened was I was right there. I was on them things. They saw me and hit the backwoods, man, you know. But, I mean, Father's always there with us, taking care of us. We don't even understand. Things come to try to take us out, huh? Oh, Prabhu Segeri Bayashaya. Hala Mombre Dej Tikita Namekutiapa. Hallelujah. Praise God for his shepherds. Praise God for the people who watches over the flock of God, who are not just basically making merchandise out of people and just telling people what it is they want to hear so that everybody, you know, they'll be in good favor with men and so they can, you know, get whatever it is they personally need out of the interaction. Praise God for somebody who's going to watch over the flock of God. Amen. Praise God for people who are going to heal the sheep of his fold. Hallelujah. Instead, let them just go on being wounded, you know. Don't worry about it. We'll get another fleecing off of you. You might be having a curable wound, but you're going to hobble around until we get to, you know, shave you one more time. Then you probably fall over dead, but we got some money in their pocket. I tell you, God is against those shepherds that do not heal the sheep. God is against those shepherds that do not show, make a distinction between the good and evil, and make a distinction between the holy and the profane. Father said he would raise up shepherds after his own heart. Hallelujah. Man, I tell you, when I read those passages of scripture in Jeremiah and Ezekiel, my heart just goes to pounding. Oh God, I want to be a pastor, because shepherd, pastor, same word in the Greek language and Hebrew language. Oh God, I want to be a shepherd and a pastor after your own heart. And then I get to read exactly what that description is. And I'm telling you right now, I fit it. I fit it. I fit it. And I know I won't be liked for it, because none of his shepherds that fit the bill were ever liked for it. Hallelujah. But we're going to get some people into heaven. Amen. We're going to see some people grow and mature in the things of the Spirit. Ha, ha, ha. Ha, ha, ha. Let's see if this other microphone works yet. No, that's still all weird. Shikandolo monjeste. Kind of hard to carry a Bible around with one hand, especially when you have a Bible as big as I do. Jesus, right now. Hastokoramande. We thank you for the appropriation of the authority of your name. Amen. Hallelujah. Pakorosea, in Jesus' name. Bataya lamunjish. Itaranai. Yeah, will you just sit right there in your mom's lap for a minute? I don't have three hands. Tonight I've got one fully occupied with a microphone. Ishibrona sekiti bilatopo ushiparanea kaya. Hallelujah. I tell you, God's going to touch you tonight. You're going to have to resist hard not to get touched by God. You're going to have to fight tonight really hard to not be overwhelmed by the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to just get yourself down into the worst case of fear and doubt and unbelief you've ever had. Not to be overwhelmed by his glory in this place. Because he's here. You know why he's here? Because I want him to be so bad. Hallelujah. He responds to hunger and thirsting. He's here because you hungry and thirsty. You wanted to be here so bad. I've seen many people been trained up into not wanting God so bad. I'm going to train you up into wanting God desperately. Hallelujah. I'm going to train you up into being hungry and thirsty for the things of the kingdom, hungry and thirsty for righteousness. You'll find out that you'll always be filled. You'll always have a move of God. Hallelujah. I discovered you can always have a move of God in your life. I don't care where you're at. You can be in the most remote places. You could be in the most difficult situation. Doesn't matter. Where are you at? Even in church, you can have a move of God in your life. Hallelujah. Well, I'm just dedicated. I love his church. And I know that his church is only his church when the power of the Holy Ghost is allowed preeminence. When his word is going forth. Amen. Where people are being shaken to the very core of their being. You know, this morning I talked about that right now you can mark it in time on your calendar that a generation now is going to be raised in the most wicked society that has ever been known to man, so far as we know, without moral restraint. Where the worst of all evils, there is no worst evil that I can think of than same-sex marriage. And then for there to be laws that mandate that people have to say that that is good, otherwise they're going to haul you off. Well, come get me if you think you can. Because I tell you right now, people are going to find out there's some people who know God, and you reach out to touch them, and you're going to be messed with. Because Father is... He's got vengeance. I mean, he's a defender. And people going to find out this ain't no Baptist ministry. This is a Pentecostal ministry over here. Amen. Hallelujah. There just ain't water around here. There's fire around here, in other words. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Ain't nobody going to touch me. No. I may end up like John, try to boil me in oil and I won't boil. Because God's got himself some people with fiery words. Ain't nobody had a fiery word like John the apostle. Read the epistle of John. You'll find it out real quick. Read the book of Revelation. You'll find out a fiery prophet. I mean, he wasn't angry either. He was a prophet in love with Jesus Christ. But he was burned up on the inside, filled up with the hot coals of heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They tried to exile him, starving to death. He wouldn't starve. He wouldn't exile. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, you know, unless the word of God goes forth with the same kind of authority and exactness and call to righteousness and holiness, there is a generation that will now collapse into the greatest immorality. Probably, I mean, it could even be greater than immorality pre-Noah's flood, wherein only 8 souls were left. I'm going to talk to you tonight about people who believe they write, and I want you to hear what Jude has to say about them. They're in the church and they believe they're right. I believe that there was probably hundreds of thousands, maybe even millions during the days of Noah that believed they were right with God. And only 8 souls were saved. I can show you for certain that many people during the times of the Northern Empire of Israel, I mean, from proof, text proof, they, from a cultic point of view of the ritual, they were doing it perfectly. But they were also worshiping the Queen of Heaven, which represents compromise with the world. And we saw what God did. And somebody said, oh, if there's 10 righteous, he won't overthrow them. Well, there was more than 7,000 during the days that God overthrew the Northern Kingdom of Israel. The misapplied verses of Scripture. Hello. And I can go on and on with these things. The people speak out these words and start espousing these doctrines that just simply they didn't think them through correctly. They didn't examine them and evaluate them more perfectly in the Word of God. And so they come up with wrong conclusions and then they have a false sense of security. I tell you, people, we want to see God's people have the Lord before them and at their right hand. We want to see God's people live out their every day, their every life, as though it's their last day, it's their last moment. We want you to have a consciousness of the judgment seat of Christ, of the judgments of God. We want you to have an awesome fear of the Lord before your eyes, because that is going to bring wisdom, that is going to bring insight, that is going to bring an understanding of what you're getting ready to face. You won't allow things to slip and slide around in your life then. If you can just have this relationship with the Lord that he wants you to have with him. you know what? The law made sin exceedingly sinful, but I'm going to tell you right now, the Holy Ghost has made it even more sinful. People have not had an encounter with God that has made their sin worthy of eternal damnation. I had that encounter. I see a lot of people, they just want a giggle and a thrill. They've not had an encounter with God. They might feel a little woozy. They've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, because I'm telling you, when you stand in the presence of a holy God, you recognize your sin is worthy of death and you can't find an excuse for it no more. There's not a justifiable reason. And it's more than just saying, Lord, forgive me for it. It's like, because it becomes something far more than just that kind of response. Then there becomes such a resolve in our spirit, such a willingness. Hallelujah. Such a separation. Hallelujah. Such a holy indignation. Such a repentance, such a godly sorrow. I don't even know. Sometimes I wonder, is there any godly sorrow? About 10 years ago, I first saw where I could say that is the rise of the apostate church. And I was so blessed. The Lord showed me that the apostate church and the glorious church ran parallel to one another, because it just kind of shocked me and scared me, you know. There's going to come a great falling away, and people, we are right in the throes of that great falling away right now. I'm going to tell you right now, when preachers or leaders say anything about sin and you're confused exactly what they said or what their stand is, they have forsaken all similitude of truth. They have gone completely lost every possibility of representing Jesus. and especially when it comes to the issues of same-sex marriage and homosexuality. Listen, God has mercy and God has grace for everybody, but you've got to understand that Paul made it very clear concerning what the reprobate mind is. He made it very clear what he's called apostasy. He made it very clear his connection with the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Blasphemy of the Holy Ghost is where you can't be convicted of sin anymore. You justify it, you say you're right, and you go to church and worship God holding hands with the person that you married to, the same sex that you are in, and that is apostasy. That is a blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Paul described in Romans chapter 1, he said, because they did not want to retain the knowledge of God, because they would not respond to God's conviction, his presence, this judgment, he gave them over to a reprobate mind to work those things which are unseemly, men with men, women with women. And he called that uncleanness, so then you can understand everywhere you read in the Bible, uncleanness. There's so many of you preaching, they've risen up upon I don't know what kind of wind of success, and they just don't know the Bible. They just don't know the Word of God. They've been so busy with whatever it is that they got to do in their big churches, they just never had time to learn the Word or something. I don't know. And so that's why these things that need to be preached, that's why these things that need to be, like I ministered out of, just all I did was just read. I just basically read 2 Peter chapter 3 this morning. Just let the Word of God, because people just say, oh, that's your opinion. It's not my opinion. It's clearly what God said. Oh, well, there's many translations of the Bible. So big deal. There's still only one text. Just because there's many translations of the Bible, and praise God, I can read the original text. And I've discovered that the King James did a good job. Most other translations did just a fine enough job for everybody to get this. Most of them anyways. There's a couple outliers. Of course, they've made the new Rainbow Bible. That one's off. Isn't it amazing that Satan steals the symbol of God's covenant? It's just nuts. It's insanity. And people don't rise up against people. Oh, we just want to be loving. That ain't loving. Watching somebody go to hell, watching even worse than that, their influence to now destroy a generation. And I'm going to sit quiet? No, I'm not going to sit quiet. I signed up to die. I signed up to give my life completely and totally. People can say whatever they want. Then they're going to say worse things about the church. Oh, they fundamentalists. Oh, they want to live in a theocracy. They want to force their will and their opinion upon the rest of us. Oh, they are evil people. Oh, watch out for them. It's going to get worse. There will become scoffers, as Peter said, in the last days. And that harkens back to the way they were treating Noah. They're going to laugh. They're going to mock. They're going to do every sneer. They're going to do everything to the point of even rising up to destroy us. They ain't going to be happy just throwing us in prison. Because in the last days, people are going to cry out, let us break off his bands. Let us break off the bands of his anointing from off of us. Let us break off his restraint from off of us. Speaking of God and of his anointed. And people, you're just going to have to just recognize that your silence, or that your compromise, or that your unwillingness to say that is wrong, that is evil. It's literally, listen to me, for your unwillingness to say that is wrong, that is evil, literally you're a participant in many souls coming under the grip of iniquity and perhaps even losing their eternity. Walking into eternity without God, because there was no voice of righteousness, because only God's word can change the tide. Only God's word has the powerful power to break the yoke. Only God's word can stand up against the forces of hell. Only his truth can throw down the lie. Only his light can dispel the darkness. That's it. Not our getting along and not trying to ruffle anybody's feathers and not trying to be whatever it is that Satan tries to make you being when you declare the truth. People, you need to get out and shout. Say, we're not tolerating that. You don't have that. I guarantee you it's going to be an unhappy day for anybody where I see a guy kissing a guy in front of me. I'm telling you right, it's going to be an unhappy day. I'm going to bring to bear the forces. Or if I'm with my grandchildren and my children, I see a woman kissing a woman, any of that display, I'm going to tell you right now, I will not stand there and tolerate it. I'll be on them. And I can slap harder than they slap. They let them come at me. In fact, they don't have to do that because weapons of my warfare are not carnal. We're going to see the power of God wither some hands, wither some arms. We're going to see people. We're going to see some people by the power of God get mute when they opened up their mouth to blaspheme. Hallelujah. That's what I mean by I can slap harder. Because the weapons of my warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. Hallelujah. I'm not going to tolerate it. I was in a situation just the other day. I saw it. I discerned it right in front of me. And I'm saying to my spirit, you foul spirit of hell, don't you bring out your ugly slithering self in front of me. I'm just going, in the name of Jesus, I bind your lust. I bind your unholiness. And, you know, God's even used me to do that, being on street corners in different places in San Diego County where gangs were just about to clash. And I just took authority over the spirit of violence. Stood there, took authority over the spirit of violence. I commanded it to leave. And everybody went home peaceably. We have more authority than what we recognized. We have more power and ability than what we less recognize. But it's always got to be willing to be vocal. It's got to be that passion. It's got to be willing to be active. And there's a force of it. Because Satan knows what you're doing with your time. He's not all-knowing. But I'm telling you right now, the demons that are harassing you, they know what you're doing with your time. Do you understand what I'm saying? Satan and the powers of darkness recognize whether or not you have authority over them. Huh? Seven sons of Sceva, right? Right? Trying to cast the devil out of one person. Right? The guy smacked the snot out of him. You know what I'm saying to you? I mean, he beat them all up. The devils that were inside of him said, Jesus, we know. Paul, we know. But we don't know you and you going down. You know? Because the bottom line of it is, God gives us this authority in him, in Christ Jesus. And we living in it, we confident of it, we're bold in it, and nothing's taking our authority or taking our confidence from us so that we can begin to be the salt of the earth that we're supposed to be. Hey, I'm telling you right now, the church is militant. And the church is also triumphant. Some people say the church is only militant right now and be triumphant later. I got news for you. It's both militant and triumphant. Amen. Hallelujah. But a church that's not militant and a people who are not militant are neither triumphant. Because Satan is very aggressive about his cause. He's very forceful. Somebody said, oh, God's not going to force his will on me. Well, Satan certainly will. The powers of darkness certainly will. You better start forcing something. Amen. And then you start forcing something, Papa's going to give you all the strength and ability that you need. He's going to make you strong in the strength of his own might and power so you can effectively deal with spiritual wickedness. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't that good? We walk around well equipped. Huh? Man, I have some of these dreams, you know, of missiles being fired from right off the coast here in San Diego, but I just walk right through the explosion unharmed. As people all around me die from it, I'm unharmed. As nuclear bombs explode, my hair doesn't even get moved out of place. I mean, it's knocking over trees, and I don't even feel the wind of it. Ha! Because I'm in another wind. I'm in another realm. Hallelujah. The flame cannot kindle upon me. Hallelujah. God told Israel, even when he sent them out into prison, into captivity because of their iniquity, because of the covenant, that the flame could not kindle upon them, those who were obeying, though. Now, that because everybody who was disobeying, rebellion, they were rebellious, they already died. They died in the war. Hallelujah. All that was left was the remnant, the children like Daniel. Flame will not kindle upon you. They can't burn you. And they tried it out. And sure enough, flame didn't kindle. They didn't even have the smell of smoke upon their garments. Hallelujah. When you pass through the water, it shall not overflow you, overflow upon you. Neither shall you be drowned. Hallelujah. Because I am the Lord your God, the Holy One. The Holy One of his people. He is the Lord our God, because I am the Lord your God, the Holy One. Hallelujah. Nobody's more mighty than God. All these people try to exercise their muscles. These nations try to exercise their works. These empires, these so-called scientists try to exercise their authority and propagate their philosophy, lying to people through their teeth, saying it's verifiable fact. Lying, they know they're lying. To try to subjugate people by the act of a satanic device and strategy. Father's greater in power. He allows this thing to run its work for a while, but I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to shut it down. He's going to come with wrath, great wrath, and he's going to execute wrath and vengeance upon all the ungodly for their ungodly deeds which they've ungodly committed. Hallelujah. Are you in James? Are you in Jude?
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Kistamboro satana me este pekina. Hallelujah. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Praise God. Jude, the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God. Let me say this. To them that are set apart and made holy. That's what sanctification means. To them that are set apart and made holy by God the Father. I was set apart and made holy by God the Father. And if God the Father set you apart and made you holy, it's a done deal.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All you got to do is rely upon him, and he's going to perfect everything that concerns you. All you got to do is willing to be obedient. He's going to teach you how to hate evil and love righteousness. Did you know that Jesus had to learn to hate evil and love righteousness? He chose righteousness and hated and eschewed evil. Hallelujah. That's everywhere. You know, this morning I spoke concerning the prophets, concerning the judgments of God. And, of course, Peter opens up the third chapter of the second epistle saying, really, listen, the prophets of the Old Testament, the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ all agree concerning these judgments I'm about to declare to you. So there are a lot of people got a lot of different ideas about the judgments of God, but I'm going to go with what was said in the Old Testament. I'm going to go with what was said by the Old Testament prophets. I'm going to go with what was said by the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ and by what Jesus said. And you're going to be wise if you do the same thing concerning the judgments of God. And you better have yourself a holy fear, because whether you believe it or not, God's coming with wrath and indignation against all sin and iniquity.
Amen.
Amen. And he's no respecter of persons. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm brandasekated, and I'm glad he's not. I'm going to sing joy and praises and honor to him. He's not allowing any wickedness in. Praise the name of the Lord. Father gives us a lifetime to choose. And it's about time you make the choice and you understand the consequences of your choice. He said, and preserved. I love that word. Preserved. Amen.
Amen.
I'm preserved in Jesus Christ. I'm kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He who began a good work in me is going to complete it. Praise the name of the Lord. Having begun in the Spirit, I'm now made perfect by the Spirit. I'm preserved. I pray God preserve your whole spirit, soul, and body blameless. I don't know about you, but that's who I am. Hallelujah. And I invite you, and God invites you, to come on over into the same faith and the same security of the believer and the same glory in the same place where we're willing to be obedient children, not fashioning ourselves in the former lust. Amen. But as he is holy, we're holy as well. Praise God. Hallelujah. Non geste karamasade. Where did baby go? I don't know. I'd like to have her in here. I need a little bit of wrestling. But you just go ahead and stay there right now. In the future, wrestle with her. Just wrestle it to the ground.
Okay.
We had her up in the high chair the other day. She's demanding to get out. So you know you're gonna stay there. This is church time practice. Just banging on the thing. I want out of my high chair. Well, want whatever you want. Scream as long as you want. You're not getting your way. You're gonna sit right there. And she calmed down. Amen. She started getting happy because it was just too much energy to be so upset. Hallelujah. Amen. She worked herself up into a frenzy and a sweat for a while. Amen. Then since she got happy, we let her down because she was happy. We're not going to let her down. She's not going to get her way in the big middle of a fit. And neither are you. In God, you're not going to get your way in the big middle of a fit. Hallelujah. Might as well just get happy so you can get blessed. Amen. Hallelujah. So you can move on. Hallelujah. Praise God. Because God's not raising no brats. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Hallelujah. He's raising people just like Jesus, full of love and mercy and kindness and obedience. Hallelujah. No rebellion in them, just brokenness and humility and submission and submissiveness and tenderheartedness towards Father. Good, proper kids. Man, I tell you, I pray over the children. Lord, let them have and move in a proper spirit. Let them move in a proper spirit. Pray over your kids. You know, if you start seeing a manifest in the name of Jesus, get after them. Huh? Shut that thing down. You see rebellion manifest, shut the thing down by the Spirit. You see a fit manifest, you shut the, that's right, come on, baby. Shut the thing down. Shut it down by the Spirit. Huh? Don't sit there and poke at them and aggravate them that much more. You know what I'm saying? Shut the thing down. Pray over them in the Holy Ghost. The proper spirit begin to work in their life. Huh. I know sometimes it's funny and you want to just laugh at it, but it ain't that funny. Hallelujah. Takara moshi yateya. Preserved in Jesus Christ and called. Come on, man. Come on, man. You didn't choose him. He chose you. Amen. He called you. Amen. Come on. Ordained you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, Jeremiah. Come on, get on over in the kingdom. Don't wait till you die. Don't have to prolong having a good time. Don't have a prolong being blessed. Don't have to prolong all the good things of heaven. God has it for you right now. Just go ahead and get in with the program. Obey God. Jesus said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord. And that's in the Greek language and in the Hebrew language, both. When you have that repetition, that would be the people say, he is absolutely my Lord. I know for a fact he's my Lord. He said, they're not coming in necessarily. It's those who do the will of the Father. Understanding the will of the Father is very important to all of us. Understanding what it is he's purposed to bring to pass into our life. Now that we've been born of God, now that we've been born again, now that we've been born of the Spirit. I'm going to tell you right now, when you were born into this world, you were born unacceptable to God. Unacceptable. You have to be born again. You have to be born of the Spirit to be made acceptable to God. And Father has made that by an act of a miraculous power at work in our life through the authority of the name of Jesus. His name is so powerful. Call upon the name of Jesus Christ in truth. Woo! Papa gives you a new heart, a new spirit. Everything begins to change. Thank you, Lord. He says, mercy and peace be multiplied to you. And he says, mercy and peace and love be multiplied to you. I'm getting ready to bring it down. Are you with me? Because that you're getting him ready. Okay, he's made a separation. Right now, he's made a distinction to those sanctified and preserved in Jesus Christ. Now he's going to talk about people who are in the church and they clearly have fruits and evidence that they do not belong to the people of God. They are not belong to the household of faith. Even though, he's going to liken them in every way to those who are in the midst of the covenant people and had upon them a covenant name. People like Cain. People like Balaam, and especially like Korah. He's going to name those. He's going to show us some things we're going to have to be aware of and be watchful of, because it's in the atmosphere. And I want you to be very careful that you don't become under its, you don't come under its influence and somehow justify it. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you concerning the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who are before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into lasciviousness. And a very important thing to recognize. They are in the church. He's identifying them in the church. He's saying they crept in. In other words, they're not a part of the body of Christ. They've adjoined themselves unto us, but they're not really a part of the body of Christ. And he's now going to begin to describe why they're not. And the first thing that he says concerning these people, these false Christians, the first thing is they say, he says, they turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. They take the grace of God and say, well, because of the grace of God, we can practice all kinds of unrestrained immorality. We can have now a license literally to sin. Okay, Paul addressed it in Romans chapter 6, verse 1. There were people that were saying, let us sin that grace may abound. They were actually teaching doctrines that now God's mercy and God's love was more magnified in that he would now even accept sinful people doing the full acts of treason and ungodliness. His grace now would be magnified in accepting them into the company. What a wild idea. What a reality that exists even right now, and more so now in the church than 100 years ago. And so it's like it's almost come full circle, but it's now actually worse. And then he says, and denying the Lord God, our Lord Jesus Christ. Now I want you to understand, he's not saying that they were denying that Jesus Christ is Savior. They weren't coming out and declaring somehow that Jesus Christ is not who he said he was. And it's proven in the rest of the chapter and the rest of his epistle, they were denying him by their works. They were saying one thing with their mouth. They were saying, yeah, Lord, Lord. They were saying that Jesus Christ is Lord. They weren't coming as those who were saying, obey the law of Moses. Because if they were coming as those who said, obey the law of Moses, my goodness, they wouldn't have been turning the grace of God into a right to commit acts of lasciviousness or acts of unrestrained immorality. Because there would have been no place in the law. There's no place in the law of Moses for that. They weren't coming in saying the goddess Diana, she's truly God, let's serve her. They weren't coming in saying Satan really should be the ones worship, let's worship him. They were there in every way saying, having the same speech, going through the same ritual, the same practice. It's just that they were saying we can sin and still be right with God. That's really what they're saying. And that is what Jude is addressing. He's saying they are denying what Christ Jesus did for us when he purchased our salvation and brought us into this living hope as a new creation. They're denying of the power of change. They're denying righteousness and holiness that is by Christ Jesus. That's what they're denying. They're denying that he is the master of their life and that he's to be the master of our life. Are you with me? They're denying that God is supposed to be the master of our life. And just saying whatever goes on, we were made this way, God made us this way, and it's not really as bad as everybody makes it. Makes it out to be, and that is sin. He said, I would therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, see, that how the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, they once knew it. But somehow they forgot. The Lord, having saved the land, saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believed not.
God saved them. Everybody got saved. Everybody passed through the Red Sea. But God destroyed those who would not obey. And over and again in the Bible, believing it and obeying it are equivalent. That's why James takes up, show me your faith without your works, I'll show you my faith by my works. Over and again, God says the hearer is not justified, but the doer. There has to be an obedience if there's truly a believing. You say you believe and you don't obey, well, the devils believe and they tremble. That's why he's saying this concept of just saying that you believe in Jesus means nothing. I come running to these people all the time. They say, oh, he's been with me and walking with me through all my life. I said, oh, have you been consecrated to live for him? What church do you go to? Oh, I don't go to a church. No, I've been doing this and that and the other thing. I said, he's not been with you. He has no fellowship with the works of unrighteousness. He ain't been with you. That's another God. That's the God of this world that brings a false comfort and brings a false peace. Amen. People don't like to hear that. Oh, well, that's your opinion. No, it's not my opinion. It's God's opinion.
He will not have any agreement with unrighteousness. He's not going to walk with you unless you're going to be willing to walk in obedience with Him. Hallelujah. God's a holy God. You have no concept of a holy God who hates sin and iniquity and has brought His judgment down upon it and has proven it in Christ Jesus when he put Him to death at Calvary. When He laid the sins of us all upon His own life. It was important for you to get out of humanism, out of doctrines of men. Oh, we're all children of God. That is nonsense. You're the child of the devil till you're born of God. And it's about time somebody become loving enough and full of the truth to go ahead and just tell people like it is and instead of trying to high-five their lie. Because I'm telling you right now, you high-five their lie, you accommodate their lie, and all you did was confirm them in their lie and became part of their lie. And their blood had dripped from your hands. You just listen to me. You had the Word of God in your mouth. You could have brought it down and they could have heard. But you were unwilling to risk your life for His name's sake, for the kingdom's sake. And I pray tonight that that wouldn't be in your life. Sukkot da bodhisteya pi. Don't you be conformed to this world. God expects you to be unspotted from the world. Hallelujah. You say, oh, well, if He's a loving God, He wouldn't send anybody to hell. You chose hell. And a loving God is going to get rid of the plague of death. Praise God. You got a different definition of love than I have. You got a different concept of love. Love doesn't just let anybody do whatever. Love doesn't let Joe go and murder Mary. Give me a break. Huh? Love doesn't let Pete go rape the 4-year-old baby. Give me a break. And let me see if I can think of something worse. Huh? Come on, people. Love don't let that happen. Hate lets that happen. People are so deceived, they use the worst kinds of illogical arguments to try to make their point. Everybody knows that when somebody does something wrong, and especially if they did it wrong to them, that they need to have to pay for it. Huh? Somebody needs to pay for the wrongdoing. People get all up in arms when somebody does something wrong, gets away with it. Everybody's upset about Hillary. Because she got away with something. I'm telling you right now, there's a deceiving spirit there. There's a deceiving, lying spirit there. I look at her and I see a ravenous beast that needs to be delivered. It's a demon. I see a demon power all over. Bottom line is everybody's all up in arms. Oh, she should have to pay. Well, you're going to have to pay too. Because your sin is far worse. And when you sin against God and against Him alone. And you violated something so beautiful and so wonderful and so precious and so sacred that He gave to you and purpose not only for you to live it, but also to be a blessing to everybody around you. And your sin has not only contaminated you, but it's contaminated the whole lump. Everybody that's gotten near you become unclean. Huh? You've been a plague to humanity with your unrighteousness. There's a responsibility, dear people. Huh? And praise God for the precious blood of Jesus that washed us and cleansed us and removed the shame, and for the power of the Holy Ghost that strengthens us and gives us wisdom and gives us insight to know the difference between good and evil and right and wrong, so we're not swamped with the lies and the opinions of men and of devils. We don't live our lives according to something that was fashioned in our lives in first and second grade. What a terrible reality. You live out your life by something some teacher told you in first and second grade. And then they spent another 10 years building on that. And then you went on into higher delusion. Or higher education, either one, whatever you want to call it. Just to help make you more, twofold more a child of the devil than they themselves. To give you that much more the spirit of the lie to go and propagate it. And then God's people go and give their children 8 hours to be taught unrighteousness and iniquity. To be taught a false history.
to be taught a false report of observation of the natural world. To be taught a skewed philosophy and perspective even upon mathematics and literature.
Jesus, help us. Why are we so unwise and foolish?
Why cannot we wake up? Because we're trapped in a culture. We're trapped in a culture.
A realm of a sociology of a caste system that exists right now has gripped us, and we don't find any way out.
You're going to have to be strong, strength of the Lord and the might of His power to break that death hold, to break that grip. Huh? I got a move. I got a great grappling move that brings it to an end.
In Jesus' name. I'm not having nothing else to do with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what you just say to the society. That's what you say to the culture of this world, to the education system.
See, I love to say that. And then, you know, we sit around in a highly educated group of people here, several lawyers, several doctors, some of different types, MD, others. Huh? But we know what it is.
Yeah.
We know what it is.
Yeah. People are trapped in that thing. And now it's getting worse. I define inner city ministries now, inner city missions, as true education, Christian education. And it's got to be a sorting out between a Christian education that belongs to the children of God's people and a Christian education that just belongs to the people of the world. But there needs to be both going on right now in the inner cities like never before. Because I'm going to tell you right now, God was kicked out of the classroom. Now He's really kicked out of the classroom. Because now He was kicked out of the classroom, no Bible, no prayer. Now He's kicked out of the classroom on the level that you must call evil good. And you must say that what God says in His Bible is wrong.
Jesus.
And it's our fault that things have come to this place. It's our fault. And the beautiful thing is we can rise up and change it. Not by legislation. Not by some governmental act. But by the authority of the Holy Ghost. Because we begin to cry out to God. Because first and foremost, in the act of intercession, we don't give any place to the powers of darkness. You got to recognize that every place you open up the door to sin and iniquity, you've just not only allowed Satan to run over top of you, you have actually abdicated the power and authority that God gave to you to change a generation. And Satan is now released to do what you were created to stop. Can I tell you again? Now Satan is released through you to do what God created you in Christ Jesus to stop. So it's not only, it's worse, it's magnitudes worse than it's just you not being willing to obey God and do what's right. Because your disobedience results in the masses going to hell and Satan having his way. God help us. We have a responsibility upon our shoulders. And we want you to be fit for the battle. We want you to be fit and equipped to deal with the adversary, the devil. Who goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, whom you and I are supposed to resist steadfast in the faith, who now Jude is trying to stir us up to contend, to get aggressive and begin to contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints, because there's people trying to change what God has established through Christ Jesus. Where's she going? It's amazing. We should just wait till she comes back. I'm not going to do that. I feel like that, though. I feel like that especially because she's my granddaughter. You know, and the call of God and the gifting of God is upon her life. That's so beautiful. We get her in the car. She'll just sing praise songs all the way home. She sings praise songs. She walks around singing praise songs all morning. It's just a continuous flow. It's like she's got a whole repertoire. Everything her dad ever sang. The other night I started singing a song. She said, "What's that that you're singing?" She said, "Is that kids' praise? You're singing it wrong." And then she started singing and I stood corrected. "You're right, baby, I'm sorry. I won't do that anymore." Hallelujah. Praise God. I love that. She needs to be in the meeting. So, well, she doesn't understand everything. The Word of God is spirit and life. You don't understand everything. I don't understand everything. Praise God, His Word is spirit and life. It's living and powerful. Hallelujah. You sit under the presence of the Lord, being bathed in the water of the Word, drinking the good things of the Spirit. You're going to be strengthened. I don't care if you're getting sleepy, you're going to be strengthened. Hallelujah. And you can go to sleep and you're going to be strengthened. Amen. But if you're over the age of 10, we're going to wake you up. Amen. He said, you remember those that came out of Egypt, God destroyed them, those that didn't obey, those that didn't believe. He says, and the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he's reserved in everlasting chains under darkness, the judgment of that great day. So the children of Abraham were dealt with severely. Before that, angels were dealt with severely. And he's going to drive home a point. You're going to be dealt with severely too for any kind of sin. And he's dealing with the issue of sin. And he's going to show us some of the sin almost seems like it's barely an offense, like murmuring. True, because it's murmuring against the Lord and against His anointed. Complaining as God brought us out here into the wilderness. He doesn't really love us. He doesn't really care for us. All these kinds of things. He says, even as Sodom and Gomorrah. So Jude is making everything that happened in history relevant to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ in the time of grace. Somebody hadn't been reading their Bible. Somebody hadn't been reading nothing, because these people are standing from platforms saying, none of that's relevant now. God doesn't deal with us the same way. Jude said, oh, yes, He does. Peter said, oh, yes, He does. Paul said, oh, yes, He does. Don't let anybody deceive you. He that does these works of unrighteousness have no inheritance with Christ Jesus or in His kingdom, but the wrath of God abides upon them, even as it does upon the children of disobedience. And you know, Peter said it in such a radical way when he's setting this up of looking at the historical aspects. He's saying, you listen to me, God doesn't change. And he says it in a unique way. He says, it doesn't matter if it was the days of Noah. It doesn't matter if it was 1,000 years ago, for a day is with the Lord 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. That means He's not evolving. He's not changing. 10,000 years is a day. He's going the same today, right now, in His judgment as He was then, in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, in the days of Noah, in the days before when the angels tried to overthrow God under the leadership of Satan. And then, of course, you know, that's really where Peter takes it up. He says, they willingly ignorant concerning the judgments of God, that the cosmos that then existed was overthrown because of the sin and iniquity. And God hadn't changed. 1,000 years is as a day, and a day is as 1,000 years. He's not evolved. He feels the same about it today, and you better listen up, and you better start getting yourself some holy fear. Well, people don't want to hear this. There's a price to pay for truth. There's a price to pay. And it seems that very few people are willing to pay the price. I want you to hear God. I want you to be equipped by God. I want you to be fit, ready for the battle. I want you to know, I think one of the most important things to be fit and equipped for the battle is to know where the battle line is. Right. know where the front is. Know what the consequences are. God is a God of reward, and He's a God of judgment. It's fundamental. It's foundational to the truth. Eternal judgments is foundational. And people who want to try to walk away from that, they're lying. They're under a deceiving power.
So he says also, Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh.
just as the angels went after strange flesh. And these things are too wicked to even talk about what Sodom and Gomorrah was doing. And I'm telling you, we on track to see it, to see more of it. Men, I'm tell you right now, sin begets sin, iniquity begets iniquity. It doesn't just stay on some kind of a normal basis. It keeps getting more depraved. It keeps getting worse. It keeps getting more vile. Watch out. You do not want to live in the world that men are creating right now. That as they remove the restraints of God, as they remove the restraints of morality, as they remove the restraints of right and wrong, and that which is just, you know, good versus evil, as they remove those restraints, and they're doing it, you don't want to live in that world. You do not want to live in that world. There's no safety. There's no place of quiet. There's no place of peace. To where Sodom and Gomorrah became so wicked, even when God came down into Sodom and Gomorrah, the people were so vile and so wicked, they had lost all sense of any kind of conviction. They wanted to try to rape God. Bring them out unto us that we may know them. They wanted to rape God. And then because Lot would not bring them out, they said, well, we'll do worse to you. And that's where the Lord raked the hole, grabbed Lot, pulled him back in, and put blindness upon all the people. And just before complete and total destruction comes, there's complete and total spiritual blindness. And I'm going to tell you right now, the judgment's going to begin in the house of the Lord. And I pray that every one of you in this place tonight, maybe there's some of you not willing to bend the knee to the Lord Jesus Christ. You've not been willing. You're living under the deceiving powers of Satan. I pray that you'll live to be shaken in reality, to see all these things come to pass and know that all you've got to do is call upon the name of the Lord. He's so good that he'll respond to you. Even on a deathbed request, he will. He'll respond to you. He's an amazing God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Hakura manjesevriya. There's a lot of people just saying not going to listen. But that's not our business. Our business is to warn them. I'm here to warn you. I don't come to people like a scribe. I come to people like a prophet. I come to people like a mouthpiece from heaven. I come to people with the authority that has been given me as a child of God. I want to encourage you to do so as well. I come to people say, I come and I lay it down. I say, you understand, I'm here to warn you. The wrath of God is coming upon all the children of disobedience. And Father's made a way for you to escape. The issue is, are you willing to come out from among them? Are you willing to stop this kind of life that you're living? God's given you an opportunity. He's calling you. But I'm going to tell you right now, your days are numbered. They're short. Oh, God. I talked to a person in the back of this building, she was within this building, too long ago. And I was stirred by the Lord as I was walking towards him. And this is the person that God has dealt with in so many ways over a great number of years, probably about 25 years. Not only in this ministry, he's on this ministry for a few years, and other good ministries that he's been in. And I walked up to him, I said, don't you say nothing to me. Your days are numbered. And he looked at me and he started to smirk. I said, you smirk, and there'll be fewer still. And he left and he didn't obey. His days were numbered. And now it's unveiled. Now it's revealed for everybody to see. I got to tell him out of the secret realm. I got to tell him in the realm of seeing it before it comes to pass. I tell you right now, we live in a time where there's scoffers. It's going to be worse than in the days of Noah when they were scoffing and laughing and mocking. It's going to be worse for those people who speak by the Spirit of the Lord. There are going to be lots of scoffers and mockers and laughers. You think we don't know what we're talking about. We just, you know, they're going to comment. They're going to make us as though we were mere men. They're going to try to marginalize us. Huh? Make us insignificant. You're going to make a servant of the living God insignificant. Hallelujah. He's living by the Word of God. I live for the purpose to make known the Word of God by the Spirit of the Lord. I pray the name of Jesus Christ that every one of you start shining with this kind of light. Start being this kind of salt. Start living this kind of good life. This is a good life to live. Huh? We wake up in the morning being mentored by the Holy Ghost to declare the things of the Spirit of the Lord. Declare the counsels of God. What a life to live.
I don't wake up in the morning in the school of the prophets overseen by Samuel or by Elijah. I wake up in the morning in the school of the prophets overseen by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. What a place. What a great place. I'm in church 7 days a week. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Hallelujah. 52 weeks a year. Amen. I don't take a vacation, don't want one. I'm on vacation being in the school of the Spirit. I'm living out the abundant life. Why do you want a vacation from the abundant life? Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. The joy-filled life. When you're sitting in the hot spot of pleasures forevermore, why would you ever want to leave? This is something that people need to understand. They've not really drank of the good things of His pleasure. They're not drinking of the rivers of His pleasure. And when you begin to drink of the rivers of His pleasure more on a consistent basis, all those other sewage won't be so look so appetizing. In the name of the Most High, Shikora Masaderine, Bola Masade. I was going to display my belt, but I didn't bring it. Yeah. Amen. Judgment is a great deterrent to remember that there is judgment. Huh? Anna, quote the scripture for everybody. Obedience is better than? That is correct. Sacrifice. Amen. She learned that scripture just before the belt was applied by the papa. Amen. And that's burned in her heart. Amen. She's a daughter. Amen. And everybody who's chastened is a son and a daughter. Amen. Hallelujah. All children are partakers of correction. To recognize you're not doing that. You're not going to behave that way. I know sometimes it's hard for parents. Oh, it's so hard. Yeah, it is so hard. But I'm going to tell you right now, if they're going to learn how to rebel against you, they're going to learn how to rebel against God at the same time. They learn how to disobey you, they're going to learn how to disobey God. Defy you, defy God. Somebody, at some point in time, we were talking to Anna the other day. Say, Anna, you've got to learn how to obey. Because when you disobey, it's ugly. And it's going to cause you to fail in every area of life, and especially in the area of your relationship with the Father, so you just start acting right. Huh? Good. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name, then we pray over. Amen. Have her lift those hands towards heaven and get filled with the Spirit. Worship the Lord. Don't you just love watching Anna up here worshiping? She's in it. I'm telling you, she's in it. There ain't no fake nothing there. She's in it. And we just remind her of who she is in God when she starts to act that way. Hallelujah. We just aren't going to leave it to the realms of human discipline. Huh? Because that's only limited. We're going to now get over into the things that the Spirit of God would supply as we begin to minister to her after that realm. Hallelujah. I think that people have failed to do these things with their children. They just want to administer the corporal punishment of the arm of flesh. They don't understand how to move in the administration of the Spirit to see change come by the power of God's Word and by the power of the Holy Ghost. He says, even as Sodom and Gomorrah, the cities that were like minor, giving themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the visions of the vengeance of eternal fire. Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Set forth as an example to who?
Us.
I'm going to say it again. Set forth as an example to who?
Us.
I'm going to say it again. Set forth as an example to who?
Us.
Us. Okay, now say it. Set forth as an example to who?
Us.
Now, revelation has come. Now, the next time somebody tells you that all these things that God did in judgment against those in former days has no application to us in the church, is taken to this verse of Scripture here.
Amen.
And a couple of verses of Scripture that I shared with you out of 2 Peter chapter 3. And then when you're done with that, I'll give you a whole bunch more. Hallelujah. Are you with me over here? I don't want anybody to walk out of this church and just have a bunch of crazy ideas about God. And come visit you one day when you're preaching and sit there wondering where on earth you went to church. Where on earth you learned the doctrines of God. I want you to have them right. I want you to know what the Word of God says. And more than that, It's the Word of God that equips you. It's the Word of God living and dwelling in, this Word of God living and dwelling and abiding in you that makes you strong and empowers you to overcome the wicked one, because you're not going to be ignorant concerning his devices and his lies and the way he tries to deceive and get you to compromise with him and get you to agree with him and get you to allow in your life things that God has determined should not be in your life, that he's empowered you to overthrow. You hear me? Propaganda lies are the worst kind. Huh? I love hearing Phil Smithers tell the story about how they bombarded their enemy, the Russians, there in Angola, with a bunch of literature saying they had like 24 hours to surrender, and if they didn't get surrendered, they're going to come in and all of them are going to be killed. And they had a force of an army something like 10 times more than they had. They were just a small little group of South African soldiers with one or two tanks, and they had like hundreds of tanks and artillery and thousands of men. But they gave them a propaganda war. The next morning they walked in there and everybody had left the tanks and ran away scared. The propaganda war works. Lies, deception works effectively. They were all imagining themselves being killed and flayed in pieces by the great South African army, and they had like one tank or two tanks and a couple of jeeps and a few grenades. And the Angolan army and the Russian army were just totally equipped. Satan does the same thing to us. Unless you got the Word of God and you got the truth, then you know that the devil's lying. You know exactly what he's got. You got nothing. You got nothing. Bring it. I'm going to give your flesh to the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Let's get valiant, okay?
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
And he says, likewise, also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, speak evil dignities. And he's talking about it in terms of the church. And he's going to make it known. He's talking about in terms of the church. He's talking about the authorities that God has placed in the church. He's talking about Peter and Paul and John. He's talking about Apollos. He's talking about those anointed of God. Huh? And then he makes another example concerning the angels. He said, yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, did not bring about a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. But these speak evil of the things that they know not. But what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them. When you hear this, judgment is coming down upon your head. Judgment upon you. Woe unto them that have gone in the way of Cain. Understand what Cain did. You know, John really set it up for us in 1 John chapter 3. He said, he talked about Cain hating his brother. And why did he hate his brother? Because his brother's deeds were righteous and his were unrighteous. And because those righteous deeds condemned him in his unrighteous deeds, he rose up to kill the witness that stood out against him that he needed to change and get right. Said they've gone in the same way of Cain. And what are they doing? They're killing and destroying the righteous. Who's he talking about? These people that are sitting in the church who say that it's okay to sin, that somehow or other God's grace is going to be able to take care of that while you continue to live and practice that which God says, let no man deceive you. He that does righteous is righteous, even as he's righteous. He that sins is of the devil. An ongoing practice of that which God has changed our hearts so that we can now hate and refuse and learn the way of righteousness is ultimately a bringing into our lives a perdition and an ultimate certain damnation, just as he laid it out concerning those who left out of Egypt that disobeyed and were overthrown in the wilderness, the angels that left their first estate, and how that they were left in chains reserved unto everlasting destruction, Sodom and Gomorrah, even unto us today, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. He says, woe unto them that run greedily in the ear of Balaam. Well, what did Balaam do? Well, I'll tell you, here's what Balaam did. Balaam, though being a man who could speak the word of God by the Spirit of the Lord, was willing for profit and willing for money and willing for gain
to go ahead and show Balak, though he would not and was not able to curse Israel, to show Balak how to overthrow God's people. So he stood there and said, how can you curse that which God has blessed? He said, I know how to destroy them. Let there be immorality among them. Send down the princesses of Moab and let fornication come in their leadership, and they'll be destroyed. And he was right. He taught Balak how to cast a stumbling block. But they've run greedily in the error of Balaam. In other words, they've been willing to sell the anointing and their ministry for money. And that's where really it stops in terms of this application right now, here in this particular passage of Scripture. He says also, they perish in the gainsaying of Korah. And Korah here in the Greek language, as it's ultimately translated from the Greek language, but Korah, as it's translated, as the Greek translated from Hebrew, Kore, from Korah. What was the gainsaying of Korah? Look, Moses is my cousin. I'm also a Levite. We know the will of God as much as he does. In fact, I believe that him and Aaron just got something going on the side. They're trying to be rulers. They're taking advantage of us. And he became fratricide. Are you with me? Creating the schism, bringing out an accusation against the anointed of the Lord, the person that God anointed to speak. He said, God speaks to us as well. We also know what the mind of the Spirit is. We also know what the will of God is. You take too much upon yourself. So Moses said, okay, well, get your censer, man. Come, let's stand before the Lord to see what he chooses. And the earth opened up and swallowed Korah and the company of leaders that were with them, and they fell straight down into hell. They didn't die till they hit the flames of hell. Then the rest of those who were influenced by Korah, you read about in on down about verse 31 in Numbers. What is it? 16, I believe. And God had fire rain down from heaven to destroy them. So, once again, Jude is emphasizing all these things happen. People say, oh, all that doesn't relevant to us because we're in the age of grace. Jude is proving, wait a minute, all that is relevant to you, and the same thing is going to happen to you. Because the grace of God that has appeared to all men teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. God has purposed that we be unspotted from the world. He has purposed that we live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. As many as are walking in the Spirit, they have proof that they're sons of God. As many as walk in the Spirit, they will not fulfill the lust of the flesh.
Amen.
That's what the Scripture says. Romans, if you want to look it up, it's Romans 8. I just quoted Romans 8, 14 through 16, Galatians 5, 16. So what happens is now, in this day of apostasy, people who know the Word of God and declare the Word of God, they sound like some people that are speaking the foreign language. Because others have sat around so long listening to people make merchandise out of them. They sit around so long in meetings that really had no truth in it, really. Didn't have the Word of God wasn't going forth. They were raised by people of the wrong spirit. And so now the hardness of heart and the deception is so great that when the Word of God comes forth, they throw it off and they cast it off. It's apostasy. It's perdition. They can read the same Bible. Here it is. This is the Word of God. They can read it page after page after page. Let no man deceive you. He that does unrighteousness has no inheritance in the kingdom of God, but the wrath of God abides upon him. Paul's message to the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 5. They just overlook it. They can't see it. They can't hear it. It's the age. Here's what he's saying. Because he's saying these kinds of people with these same demon spirits, with these same attitudes, are in your church meeting. So thus he says, these are spots in your feast. He said, these are spots in your feast of love.
And when you spot it, Father's not going to be there because a little bit of leaven leavens a whole lump. He's going to demand that you deal with it, you correct it, just as Paul dealt with it and corrected it at the church of Corinth. And he said, you get it right. Otherwise, I'm going to come there and I'm going to have to be embarrassed because I'm going to lay it out for you. These things that are going on, fornication, covetousness. He said, I'm going to run the people off. Basically, he said, I'm going to tell you right now, the sin that's going on there, you cast it out. You give them over to the destruction of the flesh. Give them over to Satan. That's what he said. He said, if there's anybody calls himself a brother among you and they're getting buzzed, have no fellowship with them. Don't even eat with them. That's what he says. And I like to say it that way because we have signs on this here on the roads in California, in case you're not from California, says if you're driving buzz, you're driving drunk. People always trying to lie to themselves and lie to people like me, saying, oh, I don't get drunk, I just get buzz. I just have a glass of wine. Well, you're destroying your liver while you imbibe those demon spirits. Somebody says, you say it's demon spirits, it's not demon spirits. Well, you tell me what it is then. If you're so brilliant in physiological chemistry, tell me what it is. I'll tell you what it is in physiological chemistry and tell you that it has the physiological chemistry and mechanism that you describe has absolutely nothing to do with it. It is a demon spirit that I can cast out. If a person comes to me drunk and wants to get right with God, I can cast out that devil and immediately they get sober. So I have something that is far more proof than a chemical mechanism that can never be validated. And we want to go toe-to-toe chemistry, let's do it. I mean, that's why the Lord took us through so much education, so we can deal with these strongholds of the mind. Amen. People think they know what they're talking about. You've been lied to. You've been deceived. On every hand, at every point, Satan has spun things to ultimately bring you into a prison. People want to say, well, Jesus drank, Jesus got drunk. He drank wine. He turned the water into wine. He made 160 bottles of wine. And they want to liken it unto modern day wine. So those guys were toasted. They were staggering drunk. They had to have somebody else drive them home in the Camel. It's nonsense. It's a lie. It's a lie. Jesus was not a glutton, and neither was he a wine bibber. That's what the liars said about him. At the cross, they tried to bring him strong drink, and he refused it. He would only receive the vinegar, which is another form of wine. It just so happens to be at the cross, those two particular ones was denoted. However, there's already many verses of Scripture that already laid it down, that drunkards will not have any part in the kingdom of God. Already laid it down, that drunkenness is a work of the flesh, a work of demonic power, as much as any other influence of a demon spirit. Now people are smoking dope and saying it's okay because God made the herb, and then getting high on dope and writing songs, you know, going, draw near to me, God, because I feel so far away, and everybody singing it. Yeah, you feel draw near to me, you feel so far away because you need to repent. And everybody's feeling the anointing singing that ridiculous song written by somebody who's just making money. That's what they do. They supposedly a worship leader. Beer in one hand, hooch in the other. Give me a break. It's filled up with demon spirits coming and going. Stuff that was born in witchcraft. Its historical place and position in history is found within the framework of sorcery and worshiping demon spirits. I show you some of the first people who advanced pharmacology, and you would say, if there's ever a sorcerer, that's a sorcerer. I show you from the 1800s, 1700s, pictures of guys, and I mean, they demonized men. Because that's where it was, even an esoteric science, just, you know, in the 40s, just, you know, 70 years ago, 60 years ago, chemistry was an esoteric science. 150 years ago, it was an occult. It was a cult, an occult. In many respects, it was. You know how benzene rings, polymers for plastic. You know how it was discovered. This guy, he has like this visions, and he saw snakes biting their tails and dancing around. Pretty wild, huh? Ah, I know what the structure looks like now. It's true, eh? Remember when Heasley told us that the first time? I'm like, dude, I knew it. I knew this stuff was just right out of hell. I used to take so many notes in genetics or molecular biology or chemistry going, if that ain't right out of hell, I don't know what is. Jesus help us. We got witch doctors. They're just a little bit different. They're more educated. They dress up nicer than the guys out in Papua New Guinea doing those weird dances that they do with the bone in the nose. Huh? I've had them in my meetings. Hey, dancing around, calling birds down to dive bomb the people. It's like, I mean, there was so many people there that night. I had Joshua and Daniel with me. There's thousands upon thousands of people. I think the biggest night is probably 30,000 people. And the witch doctors out there doing their thing, you know, trying to stop it all. It's so funny. It's so hysterical. It's wonderful when they up at the altar crying out to God, too. We can't stop this power. We called the birds and they turned on us, started pecking on our heads. Instead of pecking on everybody else's heads. Praise God. The world's about to see who's got the power. The world's about to see that the strong arm of flesh is just so strong because there's an unseen power and authority that'll wither that hand that comes to strike you. They will make mute that mouth that would rise against you to try to condemn you. Watch what's going to go down now. Hey, looky here. Look. The battle is on. Watch what takes place. These are spots on your feast of love. They feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. There's no conviction. They pass conviction. When you pass conviction, you blaspheme the Holy Ghost. Because it's the Holy Ghost that brings conviction so that you might repent and know what's right and know what's wrong. And when all of a sudden a woman can stand before a preacher, so-called, and when the Baptist church can now ordain transvestites, they blaspheme the Holy Ghost. They're beyond conviction. They've given over to apostasy, as Paul said in Romans chapter 1. Because they did not want to retain the knowledge of God, because they would not be willing to respond to His Holy Ghost conviction. He gave them over to a reprobate mind to work that which is unseemly, men with men and women with women, making and defining uncleanness so clear that nobody has to be wondering what uncleanness means for the rest of the New Testament. Come on, people. About time you start moving around by the Spirit. Start making a dividing line between good and evil. Somebody needs to stand with Father on His side. Yes. I'm there. I'm going to stay there. He says, they're clouds without water. They're carried of the winds. Trees whose fruit is withered. Without fruit. Twice dead. Plucked up by the roots. Talk about knowing them by their fruits. I mean, my goodness, there wasn't even anything there to wonder about. I mean, there wasn't even any fruit. It wasn't just plucked off. It wasn't no fruit. The thing was withered. It was twice plucked up. They tried to transplant that thing twice. It was withered dead branches. And still people couldn't get it. So it is today.
Raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame.
In other words, walking in the unbridled lust and immorality that they were preaching at the first part, that Jude, in the first part of this book that Jude was referring to, they turned the grace of God into a license to practice immorality. People going around and saying, all things are lawful. Murder's lawful, fornication's lawful, adultery's lawful, blasphemy of the Holy Ghost is lawful. That's nuts. It's insanity. It defies the whole Word of God.
People have to be totally deceived to believe that. And besides that, the context, Paul's talking about kosher food. You don't have to eat kosher food. You can eat a pig if you want. Not bacon. Deviled ham. Whatever. Things sacrificed to idols. Doesn't matter. That's what he's talking about. He's not talking about the works of the flesh. He's not talking about the ungodliness, which the wrath of God abides on. People take one verse of Scripture, isolate it, and with it try to overthrow thousands of verses of Scripture. It's total deception. See, there's no logic or reasoning within the framework of deception. People are beyond reaching in many situations because of what's gone on within the framework of the church. They've stolen from them the truth. They've hidden counsel with words through words without knowledge. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the anointing. Just raise your hands. Be filled. So lift your hands towards him, baby. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the anointing. Hallelujah. And Enoch. Listen to what Enoch has to say. Enoch is before the law. People say, oh, where there is no law, there is no sin. Nonsense. You also, once again, wrestling the scripture to your own destruction. Because dear, before, in the days of Noah, there was no law. And every human being died except for eight souls under the wrath and judgments of God. These people, these motivational preachers, it's terrible. I mean, the masses have been raised by motivational teachers. They don't even know. They don't even know the Bible. They have no concept of the doctrines of God. All they can talk about is how you can mitigate your circumstances and be more successful in life and how God wants to bless it. Your finances, give more in the offering or whatever. I don't know what all they're saying, but it's certainly a terrible situation. Huh. If they were Pinocchio, they would be exposed. Enoch, also the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these saying. Prophesied of who? Who do you prophesy? Who's Jude? Who? Listen. Who's Jude talking about, the brother of James? Who's he talking about that Enoch prophesied of? Is he talking about that Enoch prophesied of those that came out of Egypt that died in the wilderness because of disobedience? Is he talking about those that were under the northern empire of Israel that was overthrown during the days of Elijah, even when there were 7,000? Who had not bowed their knee, and yet God brought judgment down? No, he's talking about you and me right here in the church. He's talking about right now in the church. He's saying, he said, right now, those who turn, who literally deny the work of grace, they by denying the work of grace, denying the new creation, denying the change of life and the change of heart, by virtue of denying the ability to walk in righteousness and holiness, they denied the God and they denied the Lord Jesus Christ. In the church right now, he says, Enoch's talking about them. Enoch prophesied concerning these that Jude is talking about that are in the church, that are not walking in righteousness and holiness and purity, but are trying to teach people by example and by word that they can live any way they want to live and be right with God. He said, Enoch prophesied about them. He said this, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly for all the ungodly deeds which they ungodly committed. I mean, people need to fear. The fear of the Lord needs to be before you. The awesome judgments of the holy God. People have never really had an encounter with God. They've never really had an encounter with Christ Jesus. They've never really had an encounter with the Holy Ghost, because when you have an encounter with the Holy Ghost, your sin to you is going to be worthy of eternal death. True. Your sin is going to become more exceedingly sinful than the law could have ever made it. True. And then you're going to have some kind of an excuse for it's okay to do it more or less every day, because you just can't, you know, God understands we can't live without interacting with demons. We can't live without sin. God's given us everything that pertains to life and godliness, because he's called us to glory and virtue. He's given us everything that we need. He's given us everything that we need. By his divine power, he's given us everything that we need to live out lives, his life, the life of Jesus, the life of the Holy Ghost, the life of God.
because he's called us to glory and virtue. Because we've escaped. He's made us partakers of his divine nature when we were made a new creation, when we were born of the Spirit, born again. And having been made partakers of the divine nature, we've escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Hallelujah. And we give all diligence to make our calling and election sure. Hallelujah. To walk in this holiness and this purity. To be holy even as God is holy. To be perfect even as Father is perfect. To purify ourselves even as He is purified. Even as He is pure. To walk even as He is, even as He walks. Yes. And as we have received Christ Jesus, to walk in Him. To be led of the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To live in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. All this other stuff is lies. It's lies. It's demonic lies. It's the lies right out of hell, sent forth to destroy the souls of men who could have been saved. Here's what he describes them to be. These are murmurers, complainers. Watch out. Watch out. The spirit of rebellion against the anointing, the spirit of stubbornness against the anointing, the murmuring and the complaining against the anointing. When you read in Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4, you discover God said, though the work was finished from the foundation of the world, I swear in my wrath you will not enter into my rest. What was that over? Murmuring and complaining. Murmuring and complaining against who? God's leadership. Because he said, you murmur and complain against them, all they're doing, all they are is the messenger. They're just carrying out my word and carrying out my orders. You're murmuring and complaining against me. So how does he distill these people down? Ultimately, look at what he distills them down to. Murmurers, complainers, walking after their own desires. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming into the kingdom. Understand, Jesus is saying, not everyone who says, Christ Jesus is absolutely my Lord, he's most certainly my Lord, is coming in the kingdom, but those who do the will of the Father. The will of the Father is laid out and made known over and over again. Everybody is without excuse. And God, the Holy Ghost, has come to show us and lead us and guide us and empower us and strengthen us. He's raised up leaders, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for your perfection. I mean, God the Father is interceding for you. Jesus is interceding for you. Holy Ghost is interceding for you. All those that He gifted in the church, apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers, interceding for you. God's saints interceding for you. I mean, my goodness. You got all the help that you could possibly ever imagine. Murmurs, complainers, walking after their own desires. Their mouth speaks great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of an advantage. Trying to win people's favor, trying to win people's admiration, being purely Laodicean, wanting to please the people, and the people then responding, having each itching ears heap unto themselves these kinds of teachers. Pretty tough days we're living in. Praise God that Jude is going to help us understand what we need to be doing in this situation. Amen. 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 Beloved, remember the words that were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. How that they told you there should be mockers in the last times. What are they mocking? They're mocking righteousness and holiness and purity. They're mocking people that says, I'm telling you right now, you imbibe that alcohol, whether it's shakar, which is the Hebrew word for beer, which is probably one of the most intoxicating things in ancient times, and that would have only been about 4 to 5% alcohol content, or ayin, which would be wine, which would have been significantly less during that day. Now, they're mocking. Oh, you guys are just religious. Oh, you're talking about walking in holiness and purity. Oh, you're legalistic. Mockers against the truth. Mockers against the judgment of God. Oh, you don't understand grace. Oh, you guys are just, you're living in the Old Testament, you angry prophets. They're mockers. And they're walking after their own ungodly desires. Look at the fruit. The people most persecuted in the church today aren't the people sleeping around, snorting a line of cocaine, getting drunk, living crazy lives and still in leadership on their fifth wife. There's people who speak the word of the Lord, an uncompromising word commanding people to repent and change and get right with God and live in holiness and fear and have a holy conversation, knowing that God, who is no respecter of persons, is coming with holy indignation and wrath against all iniquity. Oh, those are the people that are persecuted today. It's true. And it's going to get worse. The Lord says so, that's how we know. These be they who separate themselves, making themselves special. They walk after the senses. They're sensual, having not the Holy Ghost. They walk after their own gratification of their own needs, whatever they have need, big fat bellies kind of thing, just lust for food and lust for this and lust for that and whatever it is. I mean, understand. I know there's exceptions. I know there's people who need to be healed. They have thyroid problems. They have other physiological problems that are overweight. And there's other people who just eat too many Twinkies. They don't have any discipline. Huh? Try to quench their thirst with something that just dehydrates them more. You know what I'm saying? Drink a Coke to get thirsty. Because you're thirsty, drink a Coke to quench your thirst, and you just doubled your state of dehydration. I mean, just because an advertisement made it look so good. And it tastes so sweet and not sparkly and tingly in your mouth. It's just poison. If you need to drink some bicarbonate, because bicarbonate will help your stomach at times, just go ahead and buy yourself some bicarbonate water. Put yourself a little lemon juice in there or something, or orange juice or whatever it is, you know, some cranberry juice or something. So it's trying to help you here. So here, Jude gives us the remedy of what we're going to have to do. It says, but beloved, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Woo. And now, praise God, and that you do in church and out of church, because Paul already laid the foundation of how to pray in the Holy Ghost and pray in the Spirit in church. It says, pray with the Spirit and pray with the understanding. Sing with the Spirit and sing with the understanding. Can't you just see people in the church singing by the Spirit one or two at most, and that one at a time? Can't you see that? Can everybody just see that? Where people wrestle 1 Corinthians chapter 14 to their own destruction because they have no idea what they're talking about. You know, it's phenomenal to me listening to people try to describe what interpretation of tongues is, and they've never done it. You know, it's like a doctor telling you, going to give you a quadruple bypass surgery, and all he's done is had a little bit of teaching in undergraduate school. He had physiology and anatomy class. He's going, you're not going to touch me. practice a couple of times, okay? Open up a few cadavers. Play around with a few more cadavers if you need. And get yourself some practical experience, whoever it is, you know. Somebody's on the threshold of death. They're going to die anyway. Work on them to come. You know what I'm saying? People are trying to tell you what it is, and they've never even done it. It's amazing to me that there would be people that would act so boisterous and so haughty. Huh? Come on. Can't you just... Paul said, what are we going to do then? We're going to sing in the Spirit and sing in the understanding also. He already described what singing in the Spirit is. It's singing in the unknown tongue or the divine language. And now people say, oh, well, you got to do all that one or two at a time, and then that's it. Outer limits, three or four. So that's it. Three or four people get to sing, all the rest of us got to stand around and watch them. That's nonsense. He wasn't saying that. It's everybody singing in the Spirit, just like Pentecost. It's everybody praying in the Spirit, just like Pentecost. Hallelujah. Well, I already ministered on that. I ministered that on Friday night. So I'm not going to minister that on that tonight. It's just on me, you know. The crazy notions that people have about the Word of God, about the things of the Spirit. Hey, get on over here. He said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Praying in the Holy Ghost is praying with the Spirit, and praying with the understanding also that excels out of that realm. Hallelujah. Because it's just like prophecy. It's just like revelation. It's like, you know, doctrine. And you know, Paul said, if I come speaking an unknown tongue, what should profit you unless I speak by revelation, by prophecy, by knowledge, or by doctrine? It's that excelling where we still now vocally speak by the Spirit, but it's something that we can understand, everybody else can understand as well. under the wonderful inspirations of God. So Jesus says, build up yourself in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost is here to lead us and guide us into all truth, but we're going to have to be led by Him. We're going to have to know how to hook up with Him. Otherwise, we're going to be deceived. You know what? Truth rejected is a lie accepted. He says, keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And he says, on some, have compassion, making a difference. There are some people just been infected by this. They were raised by the motivational preachers and those who've taken advantage of them and making merchandise of them, and they can be saved. Make a difference on them. Go ahead. Deal with them. Declare to them the whole counsel of God. See if they will respond. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire. I'm looking to pull some people out of the fire, snatch you out of the fire tonight. Some of you look like to me that you're really close to being there. Snatch you right out of the fire. Hallelujah. You'll be happy. You might a little struggle about it because you don't understand where you're at, but somebody else does, and they reach a hold of you and grab you and jerk you over into a safe place, and you thought it was a place you didn't want to go till after you became aware of what circumstance you were in, actually. Plucking them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted with the flesh. Hallelujah. God wants us to go, as we ministered to you this morning, as Peter described, being unspotted, blameless. That's how we're supposed to live our lives in all holiness and godly fear. Being unspotted from the world. Amen. Hallelujah. God said, come out from among them, be separate, saith God, and I will receive you. Jesus said, if you love me, he said, if you keep my sayings, and my Father will love you and will come dwell with you. Hallelujah. I want that more than anything, don't you?
Yes.
I tell you, every bit of obedience is worth it. God's got great reward. Hallelujah. Now look at this. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling. Oh, hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to keep you from getting carried away in all these lies and seditions and all these things that would cause you to live a life of ungodliness. Now unto him who is able to keep you falling and to present you faultless before his presence. Before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Doesn't that sound like fun?
Yes.
Jesus. That's going to happen to me one day in the near future. I'm going to be presented before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. The Lord's going to say, well done unto me. He's going to say, well done to me. And say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Man, I like to think that all heaven's just rejoicing when I go to preaching.
Amen.
Somebody's telling it. Somebody's preaching the word. Somebody's declaring it like it is. Somebody's not willing to water it down. Somebody's not willing to compromise. Somebody themselves has not come under the influences of demon spirit. They themselves know how to keep themselves unspotted from the world. Therefore, they can declare it with boldness and faithfulness. Hey, we got somebody who's a spokesman for us. We got a great cloud of witnesses. My wife said a great cloud of witnesses is shouting right now over us.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And it's true. Hallelujah. We have a great cloud of witnesses that are there cheering us on. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We got a lot of people testifying. You can walk out this life in God. You look back in Job chapter 1 verse 1. We discover that Job was a man who was upright, who was perfect before the Lord, who walked in the fear of the Lord and did not allow evil in his life. It's been God's cry and plea and decree from the very beginning. All the prophets of old testified of this. The apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ testified of these things. Jesus testified of these things. And these are the things that we're going to testify. These are the things that we believe. You believe anything else, you believe in another gospel. You believe another gospel, you're not going to make heaven. Paul brought it down that way. He brought it down in a way which actually is an amazing decree, because he just simply said, if you believe that you need to be circumcised to be right with God, you've departed from the faith and made grace of no effect in your life. You've been brought back into bondage. The faith has been overthrown. He made it very clear, you're not right with God and you're on your way to an eternity without God. I mean, fathers, with respect to Paul, he was very exacting about doing it exactly the way God said to do it. And Father has given us an example and a model that no one can mistake. And that example, that model, is Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son. And we're called to come and follow Him, take up our cross, deny ourselves, and follow Him. Jesus has come and displayed all the beauty and all the splendor of Himself, and it's been recorded for us and written down. Hallelujah. And with great exactness. And now the Holy Ghost has come to reveal Jesus and reveal the Word, the eternal Word, Christ Jesus, and the Word made flesh, Christ Jesus, and the Word that is written in the Word that we call the Bible. And we pray tonight that every one of you here tonight, you'll flee from the wrath that is to come. You'll set the Lord before you, and you understand how to walk in the fear of the Lord, an awesome awareness of His judgment and His hatred of sin and iniquity. We pray in the name of Jesus, you'll come under Holy Ghost conviction and be happy to live there. Hallelujah. Somebody said, you mean we got to feel bad about ourselves all the time? Well, I don't know what you're doing. I guess if you're sinning all the time, you must better be feeling bad about yourself all the time. I live in awesome awareness of God and feel good about myself all the time. Somebody say, living in condemnation, culture of condemnation? No, there is therefore now no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit.
Yes.
Hallelujah. 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 Well, you know, I'm just believing God tonight for just a couple of things. You know, most importantly, one of the things specifically for tonight is asking the Lord to do some creative miracles in the house. Hallelujah. And, you know, let me just tell you this right now. People are under the idea that somehow signs, wonders, and miracles is a proof that you've been born again. It's not. That you've overcome the world is proof that you've born again. That you've overcome sin. I write unto you, young men, because you're strong, the word of God abides in you, and you've defeated Satan at every point. The proof that you've been born again is that you walk in the Holy Ghost, you walk in the Spirit of holiness, and there you did not fulfill the lust of the flesh. The proof that you've been born again is the spirit of obedience at work within your life, desiring to do that which pleases the Father. Amen? The proof that you've been born again, because the greater one, the one who's greater than he that is in the world, lives and dwells on the inside of you. Beloved, believe not every spirit, for many false spirits, many false prophets have gone out into the world. Try the spirits. Every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. But you've overcome them, little children, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Kuz de bayeshti. Dana nekietia. Lomande beshti baradeyoshu. Beyane nekeshia. Baniya ki barano shibarade. Lemanda beshira. Father, I thank you for delivering this dear woman from every Hindu idol that has ever been erected. Give her life completely over to you. So many Hindus just put Jesus up there along with the rest of the demons. He's not a demon. He's God. So how's your husband doing? Huh? Today, good news. Well, you know, the doctors weren't being mean to you. They were just telling you the truth. There was nothing they could do for him. But Jesus did something for him, huh? Pretty amazing, isn't it? Jesus is amazing. Hallelujah. He is the only holy man. Hallelujah. But he made me a holy man too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus just comes and does these amazing things for people. Hallelujah. He's God. Hallelujah. He hates death as much as he hates sin. Thank you, Jesus, for touching the lives of this family. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you for the salvation of all Sri Lanka, of all India. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Suzu zita moreteo moshia te maya. Hazabudalani. Hambramandalish. Halamamradeya. People, we want you to be fit and equipped to deal with the tribulation, to deal with the temptation, to deal with the tryings, to deal with all the things that come at us from all that is in the world, the lust of flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, so that you might find yourself being an overcomer even as He is an overcomer. Hallelujah. Jesus said, if you overcome as I overcame, then you will sit down with me in my throne as I've sat down with my Father in His throne. People want to make it different. It's all lies. Of course, Jesus is the truth. And people say, how is that even possible? Father equips us. All we have to do is hear the good word of God and be taught of God and be corrected and be willing to walk with Him. Amen. Hallelujah. How many people tonight in this place, you need a creative miracle? How many? You need a creative miracle. What's going on with Lucas? What happened? Huh? What happened? Does that need a creative miracle? That was easy. That's not a creative miracle. That's just a simple healing, just dealing with the poison. But that's okay. It's good to understand the difference. Creative miracle means we need an organ. There's not one there. One time we were, hey, I think you need a creative miracle. Touch right now in Jesus' name. Be blessed right now in Jesus' name. There was a dear woman. The Lord sent me over to her house. And the Lord said to me, before I walked in the building, she said, just ask her whatever she wants. I'll give it to her. So I went in there. I said, she's Japanese from Japan. And she said, as opposed to Japanese from America. I said, what do you want? God said, I'm going to give you whatever you want. She said, I want a baby. I said, you got one. She said, do you realize what you're saying? I said, yeah, I realize what I'm saying. And there's a few other things she said, but nonetheless, getting to the point, she said, I don't have a uterus. I don't have any ovaries. I said, obviously you do now. And you know, they had several babies. That's creative miracle. We didn't have to dance around, call down. Just speak the word, amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Some people, they want you to pray longer. You know what I'm saying? They want you to pray longer. They just figure it's going to work better if you pray longer. No, not necessarily. The word of faith is what you need. Hallelujah. Just one word. Sends forth His word, heals. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lucas, how's your little hand? Does it feel better? I command the pain, the infection to go out of it. There'd be no more swelling in Jesus' name. I command it to go down. In Jesus' name, I command that swelling and all response of that bee sting to go now. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The swelling's going down now. Inflammation goes down now. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift that little hand up in the heavens and praise God with it. That's okay. The Lord bless him anyways. Heal him anyways. God's just good like that. Who else had it that needed a creative miracle besides? I've got one I'm specifically going after tonight. My son needs a creative miracle in his back. And I want to see that happen tonight. How many people raised their hand and need the creative miracle? Huh?
My granddaughter.
No, I mean here, right now. I'll get to that later, but I mean here, right now. What was going on over here? Huh? He's got them. Wave at me, Joshua. Joshua went in, they had x-rays of that. They had missing adult teeth. They went back in, x-rayed again. They were suddenly there. So as soon as we know what the need is, we can get it supplied. How old was Joshua when that happened? Come on. About 12. How old is the little guy over here? He's 8? Good news, buddy.
You're not going to be no snaggle tooth. Hallelujah. You have all your teeth. Huh? Father created his image in his likeness. See, people haven't been around very long. They just think I'm talking. Huh? People been around here long enough, they realize, hey, something good going down. Praise God. Savitri, how are you doing? JMC. Who else was it? Who else is in need of a miracle? Who else? What's going on? You need teeth. Okay, we're going to work with that one. I just move in the realms of faith. I just remove when faith hits me, inspiration, faith hits me, go with it. Just, otherwise, we just pray through it. Okay? We're not done here. Don't feel like you're being left out. I'm just doing inventory, see what we got to deal with. See, the job of work to do. What's on the agenda? Amen. What's over here? What's up? Your hair. Are you about ready for hair? The hair work thing to be done? Huh? You about ready? Inside and out? Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Whew. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, we're just thanking God for miracles, signs, and wonders. Whew. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the miracle. You can reach out and grab the miracle. Whatever it is that you need, just reach out and grab the miracle. Just reach out and grab the miracle. Whatever it is that you have need of, just reach out and grab the miracle. Whatever it is that you have need of, just reach out and grab the miracle. Jesus is here. The healer is here. What's wrong with your daughter?
It's my granddaughter.
Your granddaughter.
Diagnosed with stage 2 autism.
Stage 2 autism? Who diagnosed her? I mean, what doctor? Colorado doctor?
Yeah, Colorado doctor.
I wouldn't put too much into that. I wouldn't give that too much value. Huh? Did he describe some medication to go along with that?
No, he said there was nothing to do about it.
Well, that's pretty good. Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for your goodness.
Yes.
This thing that Daniel's had to wrestle with. I was so blessed the other day. You know, somebody had some back troubles, and Daniel said, I have a special anointing for backs. And not being overcome by the situation that he's having to deal with in his own back. We're rather looking something beyond that.
That's right.
Looking at something that God has done and will do to anybody who would believe. Because sometimes Satan tries to defeat you at some point, to challenge your weakness and tries to just, you know, get you to capitulate on God. Father, I thank you for the miracle tonight. Son, look at me.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Father, set upon your blessings. Be set with great passion to take good care of you.
Amen.
Now and throughout the ages to come.
Yes, my God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, Father, I command in the name of Jesus.
Yes, my God.
Every disc and every part of the structure of the spine.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
to be fixed, to be straightened, to be made whole.
Yes.
Father, we thank you right now.
Yes, Lord.
For your life-giving authority, for your life-giving power that you've given to us.
Yes, Father.
Father, we thank you that this tormentuous pain,
yes,
this affliction, comes to an end.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Everybody, just stand with me. Those of you who need a miracle, I'm going to pray for you in just a minute. We're going to have you come up. We're going to pray for you. We're going to hook up in faith with you. And the Lord's going to touch you. Everyone who raised their hand needs a miracle. There's also some people in here tonight. You need a miracle of salvation. You need the miracle of change. You need the miracle, the greatest miracle of all, that results in God the Holy Ghost coming and living on the inside of you. And the abundant life, the wonderful life, the glorious life, the very life of God filling you to the point that it's more than you can contain. It comes gushing out of you like rivers of living water. Hallelujah. Sikoma Naya Shea. Hallelujah. Just move that back a little bit, back and forth. Eshimaya. Irishaina Mutana Estipuranaya Pushipiranaya. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Arinazuridia Ranamazidia Ranamazora Dia Sarana Maku Iki Ashilanane. And I want to pray for you. I want to pray for every one of you tonight. If you do not know that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, if you've not been born again, maybe some of you were baptized as children. I run into this all the time. Well, I was baptized as a baby in the church. And No. I'm talking about you calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you want to be delivered from sin and iniquity. You want to live out the life that God purposed you to have. That event where God the Holy Ghost begins to draw you into the kingdom of God by Holy Ghost conviction, showing you and revealing to you that Jesus Christ is the one who came to save you and deliver you out of a state of sin, out of a state of iniquity, out of a state of spiritual death, who's come to bring you the privilege and the access to be born of the Spirit, to be born of God. Tonight, God wants to work a miracle so that you can be born of Him and you can move into the realms of heaven. He can move into the realms of your life and take full control. That miracle, Father, wants to work in your life tonight. If you're watching by web, if you're watching by YouTube, it doesn't matter. The Lord wants to work that miracle for you right where you're sitting, right where you're standing right now. All you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity and truth. It doesn't matter where you're at. The power of God will come upon you, and the Spirit of the Lord will change you and give you a new heart, a new spirit, and He will come and fill you with His glory and fill you with His presence. And you'll never be the same again. Everything about your life will be changed. And then it's each person's responsibility, so being changed now, to follow on to know the Lord, to do those things which God has commanded us to do, to be a part of the body of Christ, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, to find ourselves being nourished on the good milk of the Word of God, the good bread of the Word of God, the good drink of the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. So that we might be strengthened and built up in Him. And also, I also want to give every person in this place opportunity tonight to worship the Lord in giving. And because there's a miracle there. There's a miracle of financial provision that happens there. I'm telling you right now, there is a lot that goes on with this just beside the giving. I'm going to tell you right now. It needs to be something sacred. The offering is something sacred. The seed is something sacred. It's always represented Jesus. It's always been about the kingdom of God. It needs to be about that in your life. If it's not about Jesus, and if it's not about the kingdom of God, and if it's not about worship, it's not going to do anything for you. If it's not a display of your relationship with Him, it's not going to do anything for you. It's not going to work just because you gave. That's nonsense. I'm going to tell you right now, but if you're walking in the fear of the Lord and you're walking in obedience to God and you're walking in those things that Father has ordained for you to have, He wants you to prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. In other words, He wants things to be right in your spirit. He wants things to be right in your life. Soul really is a synonym word for life, the whole of the life of men. But if, But in the context of that, walking this out with God. Hallelujah. Father promised to take that which we sow, because this is our heart, to be a part of those things that God is doing, both in the church and throughout the nations. He wants to simply bless us so that we might be able even to be a bigger blessing. God blessed Abraham so that he could bless all the nations of the earth. Do you understand me? Hallelujah. God didn't just bless Abraham so he could just be blessed. God blessed Abraham, hallelujah, so he could be a blessing to all the ends of the earth. I mean, he might have dwelled in a tent. I guarantee you, outside it looked like something simple. But you walk in that side of that place, I guarantee you. Amen. It was decked out. That's just the way we want to be spiritually. Inside, it's decked out. Outside, it might look like just something just average. But inside, my goodness gracious, it's filled of every good. It's filled up with every good thing. The riches of Abraham were all there inside his tent. They didn't have banks back in that day. You want to misunderstand? Do you understand what I'm saying? God blessed him with abundance of gold and of silver. Huh? And with all kinds of cattle and everything, all these good things. Amen. Where he stacked that up in his house. Hallelujah. In various different ways. Praise God. Praise the name.